Good morning, Camp family. Grace and peace to you in the name of the risen Christ. So good to be in worship with you today. I invite you as we move into a posture of worship to invite people in the comment section on Facebook and YouTube to pass the peace with one another as we prepare to receive the Word of God for us, the people of God. Let us pray. Most good and gracious God, we give you thanks for this time to worship you. May you move us from a theology of scarcity that says we don't have enough to a theology of abundance, which says, God, in you we have more than enough. God, open our minds, open our hearts, open our ears by the power of your Holy Spirit that we would hear and receive what you have to say to us today. We pray all this in your Son's name. Amen.
Have you ever got so caught up in an activity or doing some project that time seemed to slip away, that you lost total track of time and all of a sudden you realize you're hungry? Or have you ever been hungry? Have you ever been sick? Have you ever had a fever and it's just laid you out and you felt miserable? Or ever been in the hospital where you're staring up at the ceiling, you're trying to sleep, but there's all the beeping of the IV pumps or the nurses coming in. There's that strange mix, right? You're frustrated by all these things keeping you awake, but you know those are very things that are there to heal you. The story we're about to read from the scriptures, Jesus and his disciples, they see a large crowd, more than 5,000 people. People who need healing and people who will end up being hungry. So I invite you now to hear the scripture from Matthew's gospel.
Today's scripture reading is from Matthew 14, verses 13 through 21. Now, when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them,
"They need not go away. You give them something to eat."
They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said,
"Bring them here to me."
Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds, and all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children.
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Now Jesus had gotten into a boat to spend some time alone. He was spending some time alone because he was grieving. His cousin, John the Baptist, had just been executed, just been murdered, put to death by Herod the ruler because of there was some deceit and there was pride going on in this ruler's house, and John ended up being put to death as a result. And Jesus is grieving, he's mourning, he's wanting to be alone. And he's out on the boat, he's approaching the shore, there is a large crowd waiting for him. Jesus, he sees this large crowd who scrambled on foot to catch up to him. I wonder how many in that crowd had heard some of the parables and shared it with some of the other people, heard parables about mustard seeds and yeast. Or maybe some of the crowd, or maybe a lot of the people in the crowd had seen or heard the stories of Jesus giving sight to the blind. Or maybe they had heard the story of Jesus calming the storm. And whatever it was they heard or whatever it was they witnessed, they were hungry for more. So they chased after Jesus and ended up on the shore, thousands upon thousands of them. And they were hungry for something more. Now, this story that's about to unfold is the one miracle story that is in all 4 Gospels. As Matthew renders a story, and his version of it, he seems to emphasize a word. He wants us to hear, when Jesus saw this great crowd, Jesus had compassion. Compassion is what leads us straight into this miracle. I wonder if Jesus' own heart was softened because he was experiencing grief and his own suffering. His heart was softened to have compassion on this large crowd. So I wonder what it was like for this crowd to be there, because what happens, Jesus shows up and out of compassion starts healing the sick. And maybe the crowd is there and they're hearing stories. Maybe the people in the back are hearing stories about something happening up front of Jesus healing somebody. Or maybe somebody in the crowd recognizes, they see someone walking. Hey, that was that blind guy I saw just the other day. And he sure doesn't look blind anymore. And there's this excitement, and they've been there so long, they lost track of time and they're getting hungry. And it's interesting. Jesus isn't the only one showing compassion in this story. Jesus has his disciples there with him. They're witnessing all of this. And maybe it was James, maybe one of the other disciples who all of a sudden it's getting late and he starts feeling a grumbling in his tummy and he starts looking out, oh my goodness, this crowd, they're going to be hungry. And he talks to Matthew, what should we do? And they go to Jesus and say, Jesus, we've got to take care of this. This great crowd of thousands upon thousands, they're going to be hungry. It was compassion that Jesus had that cured the sick. It was compassion that would move the disciples to say something. And they point out where they are in this deserted place, and they suggest, hey, maybe we should send everybody back home, send them back to the village so they can go get some food, get something to eat, because I'm telling you, Jesus, they're going to be hungry. They saw the need. And it was compassion that led them to see the need and to make this suggestion. And that makes me wonder, around us today, what are the great needs of this community that we see? Are there large crowds in our community that are hungry, hungry for healing, hungry for food, hungry for other things because they need help? When we look at the crowds, are we like the disciples and are we filled with compassion and do we see? So when we look out at this community, do we see our eyes open to see those who are struggling right now, struggling with mental health because this pandemic has shifted and changed everything and people are experiencing fear and isolation and it's causing harm? Mental health is, people are struggling with mental health right now. Are we seeing this? And do we have compassion? When we know that, I've been looking up and reading some statistics about our community here in Brunswick County, and there is an opioid epidemic here. There are beloved neighbors here in our community that are trapped, have in this addiction, this struggle right now. And this is not just a few people, not just a handful of people. This is a big part of our community. The disciples saw the need, saw the hunger of the people right there, saw the great need of that great large crowd. Do we see the needs of the community around us? Or what about the great number of people who are experiencing life in this polarized posture that they're experiencing how life keeps getting limited to a smaller and smaller group of people who are only they only associate with because they hold the same religious views or hold the same political views. And people are starting to feel more and more isolated and alone. And it's causing rifts. This posture of polarization is causing rifts in families and in communities. And are we seeing this with the same kind of compassion the disciples saw the great crowd there? The disciples, they see the hunger. And I got to say, it must be overwhelming for them. So they asked Jesus, hey, let's send this large-scale need away. Let's send them home. Let's put this out of sight. Let them go take care of it. They suggest to Jesus, let's let this go away. But instead, Jesus invites the disciples and us to respond to the compassion that we have by drawing nearer, drawing closer to the need. Jesus says, they don't need to go away. And what's interesting, we typically, at least when I read this passage, I typically get excited about the multiplication part, right? This story where we rush into thinking how Jesus takes this little bit and all of a sudden makes it a lot to take care of everybody's needs. But we need to not pass over too quick the disciples' role in this story. We don't need to pass over quick our role in the work of God's healing in the world. Jesus turned to the disciples. When they, out of compassion, named this great need, Jesus turns to the disciples and says, you give them something to eat. Jesus invites them to not only see the need of the crowd, not only to have compassion, but to act faithfully to that compassion that's within them and move toward the need with whatever resources they have. And watch close at who's actually feeding the crowd. So Jesus would take what they offered, some bread and some fish. Jesus would echo in the communion, echoing Eucharist, takes it, blesses it, breaks it and gives it to the disciples. And it is the disciples who go and feed the crowd. It is Jesus isn't the one who fed the masses. It is the disciples who took what was blessed and given to them, and they went out and fed the hungry. They are the ones who participated in the mystery of God making more to feed those who were hungry and all mysteriously having their fill. The disciples were actually participating in answering the prayer of thousands of people who were praying, "Give us this day our daily bread." And the disciples became an answer to that prayer as they shared what was blessed and given back to them. And I'm sure they felt powerless when they first looked out at thousands upon thousands of people. The scripture says 5,000 men, not counting the women and the children, who must have been there. We wouldn't have said it that way. So what was it, 10,000, 12,000? I don't know. But it must have felt overwhelming, and they may have felt powerless. Or what about us in the midst of a pandemic, when we see how it's impacting the world and we see all these struggles in our community, do we feel powerless? Because the disciples must have, because they said to Jesus, we have nothing but a few fish and some loaves of bread. Now I'm telling you, camp, I have found great joy in our campfire meetings as a way of swapping stories, of hearing the great, beautiful things that are happening, that have happened in the past, that are happening right now, hear it in our camp family, in our community. We've asked this one question: what does Camp United Methodist Church do well? And I'm here to tell you, as a family of God here at Camp United Methodist Church, right now, if you open your eyes, you have much more than a couple of fish and a handful of bread to give to Christ to bless. I've watched and heard all these stories about discipleship that happens here. There's amazing teachers here, amazing Sunday school. I mean, we've heard about Bobby, of Calvin, of Ted, and others who are great teachers. Now, I know this pandemic has turned things upside down. We haven't been able to do it in the normal pattern, but here is one of the gifts that is here, this amazing Sunday school program. I wonder if we could offer this to Jesus and say, well, look, we have nothing but this. I've heard amazing stories of these journey groups, these intentional, small, relational discipleship groups that have prayed together, studied the scriptures together, but they have intentionally tried to help each other, not just experience Christ in a one-time moment on a Sunday morning, but how do we live this life of abundance in partnership with Christ and Christ's love moving and healing in us? And I've heard amazing story after story. Maybe this is something that we should be going, Jesus, we have nothing but these journey groups. We offer that for Jesus to bless. I've heard amazing stories about this partnership we've had for years. It's been an example to our whole conference about our partnership with Union Elementary School. And it's been a way we've blessed the teachers, blessed the administration, been a blessing to the students and the parents. I wonder, in this particular season, when it's going to be harder than ever, in this unprecedented way for all these administrators, these teachers, these students to enter into a school year that's been like no other school year they've experienced before, I wonder if this partnership we have could be something we say, Jesus, we have nothing but this. And we ask Jesus to bless it and see what happens. Another thing that I've got to bear witness to in these campfire meetings is how you have claimed these amazing stories of people being welcomed with hospitality, acceptance for who they are, this great love, great welcome. In a world that is experiencing division, experiencing people, all this polarization, what if we, I know we don't meet on Sunday morning like we regularly do, but this great gift that is Camp United Methodist Church, this love, this hospitality, this welcome, this acceptance that is our way of life here at camp, what if we offer that to Christ right now in the midst of a pandemic and take it outside of these walls? After Jesus blesses it, how many people would experience healing because we offer this gift that is here at camp? These disciples, they participated in the miracle by offering just what they had in that time of need when they saw thousands upon thousands, an overwhelming group of hungry people. Camp, in this time where there is great need all around us, I want to encourage you, as a people of God and as a church family, as disciples of Christ, we have much more than a couple of fish and some loaves of bread. We have amazing gifts to offer. I wonder what would happen if we offer it all, offer ourselves and our gifts to Christ right now, to ask Christ to bless them, to break them, and watch what happens when they get, when Christ gives these gifts back to us. Not just to feed us, not just to heal us, not just to nourish us as a camp family, but for us to participate in, for the life of the world. We give these things away to bless the community around us, to see the needs around us, and we give ourselves and these gifts away to bring healing and hope, life and love, forgiveness, mercy, to bring healing. I wonder what would happen. I wonder if our imaginations might be expanded, what God can do and what God is up to. I wonder who all in our community who are hurting, who are hungry, who are needy, who's going to eat and have their fill. I wonder if you and I are going to discover basketfuls of leftovers. I wonder if we're going to discover who God really is. And what God really wants to be up to, not just here inside the walls of Camp United Methodist Church, but in us as a family and out in this community. I wonder if we're going to be awakened to who God is and what God is doing in us and through us. If we want to simply offer what we have to Christ. May we do this together. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Saints of God, in response to God's good word for us, let's enter into a time of reflection and response. You can do this in your own prayer time, or also invite you in the comments to respond. So here's some questions to guide our reflection time. What are the great needs that you see in our community, the community of Camp United Methodist Church, in the community of Shallot, in the community of Brunswick County? What are the great needs? And then, what are the gifts and strengths of camp? Our loaves, our fish, that Christ can take and bless. And then, how is Christ inviting us to imagine new ways of using these gifts that Christ has blessed to address the great needs of our community? How is Christ inviting us to imagine new ways of using these gifts that Christ blessed?
I see his love.
Church, one of the ways that God invites us to respond to the word is through prayer. As Christians, we believe that prayer is one of the cornerstones of our faith. So I invite you to take a look at that weekly prayer list that's sent out from the office. And if you're not getting that prayer list, please contact one of us or contact the office so we can make sure you are plugged in to the needs of our community. And we ask you to pray fervently for people who need healing right now. In addition, we give thanks, and we invite you to give thanks for someone who's been a blessing in your life. If you've seen the light of Christ in someone this week, we invite you to text or call them right after the service. You would be amazed at how far just a simple act of kindness goes when you say, "Hey, thank you for being the light of Christ for me." We all need that connection right now. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the ways that you are working in our lives. We give you thanks for those inside and outside our camp community. We pray that we would continue to have a theology of hope in a world that is so dark. We pray for those who are hurting that need your healing touch. God, you are the great physician. We know that when we lift up prayers to you, it never falls on deaf ears. When our prayers are many, when our hearts ache, we know, God, you are more ready to receive than we are ready to give. So we just lift up everything in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Saints of God, saints of Camp United Methodist Church and beyond, receive this benediction. May the grace of Jesus Christ, who takes our gifts, breaks them, blesses them, multiplies them, puts them back in our hands so that we can be those who go into the world sharing God's grace with all, so that all may know God's love, God's peace, God's healing, and God's wholeness. Go in the power of Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen.